HarperCollins and Harper Audio present The Big Lie, a Jack Swyteck novel by James Grippando. Performed by Jonathan Davis. The great enemy of the truth is very often not the lie, deliberate, contrived, and dishonest, but the myth, persistent, persuasive, and unrealistic. John F. Kennedy. Chapter 1. Balloons. Countless balloons. Jack lifted his gaze to the domed ceiling above the jumbotron, his attention drifting from the monotony on stage. Suspended high in the rafters, nestled in giant nets that stretched from one end of the arena to the other, thousands of shiny latex balloons hovered like red, white, and blue storm clouds, ready to burst and bury the 4,763 delegates on the convention floor. It had taken nearly a half century for the Democratic National Convention to return to Miami, and probably with good reason. The convention that had sent Senator George McGovern off to slaughter was remembered only for air conditioning so faulty that delegates passed out from the South Florida heat, and organization so lacking that the acceptance speech was delivered after most of America had gone to bed. So uneventful was it that just 4 years after clashing with Chicago police and shouting, "The whole world is watching," leaders of the anti-war movement spent most of the 1972 convention at the Poodle Lounge or the Boom Boom Room at the Fountain Blue Hotel on Miami Beach, talking about the good old days. "From my first day in office to my last," the nominee droned on, "my primary mission as president will be to create more opportunity and more good jobs with rising wages." It was yet another stock line from Florida's junior senator, which drew dutiful applause from the nation's most enthusiastic Democrats, who were determined to make their nominee's uninspired speech worthy of primetime television. Some delegates on the convention floor looked on with adoration in their eyes and tears streaming down their faces. Jack could only guess what moment in party history they were reliving in their minds to tap such emotion. As for Senator Evan Stahl Jr., history would record that his 90-minute speech had hit its high point roughly 89 minutes before its ending, with "I accept your nomination with humility, determination, and boundless confidence in America's promise." Jack was still counting balloons. There appeared to be an equal number of red ones, white ones, and blue ones. He wondered why. The American flag was mostly red and white. "God, this is awful," his father muttered. Harry Swyteck had been Jack's ticket to the convention. The former governor and his wife were guests of honor, but Jack's stepmother was feeling under the weather, so Jack got the former first lady's ticket. Father and son joined distinguished Democrats in a mezzanine-level box that came with theater-style leather seats, flat-screen TVs, a wet bar, and waitress service. Had the arena been rocking for basketball instead of politics, not even a second mortgage on the house could have put these seats within Jack's financial reach. "So it's not just me?" Jack whispered. He and his father were standing in the back by the bar, a semi-private area that was perfect for business talks that couldn't wait until after the game, the concert, or whatever the event.
"I've heard filibusters more interesting."
That was quite an indictment. Decades earlier, Harry had served in the state legislature with Senator Stahl's father, where they'd once combined to read the entire Tallahassee phone book into the record to filibuster a bill. "What's wrong with him tonight?" Jack asked. Harry didn't answer, but Jack's question was sincere. Evan Stahl was a skilled politician, and by all accounts, he was living a charmed life.
Stahl had been a three-time NCAA scholar athlete at the University of Florida and a Rhodes Scholar, then earned a law degree cum laude from Harvard. He'd returned to Florida with big political aspirations, marrying the daughter of a Cuban immigrant turned multimillionaire. The ultimate American success story certainly didn't hurt his meteoric rise from state legislator to congressman to junior U.S. senator. As if to complete the presidential package, his wife had her own career as a hospital-based psychiatrist for the Florida Department of Law Enforcement, treating institutionalized inmates, but still finding time to raise a 9-year-old daughter who was as smart and passionate as her mother. "I'm serious," Jack whispered. "Something's not right here." Some said that the senator was most effective in a town hall setting, where he could engage directly with people. But never had he fallen on his face at the teleprompter the way he had tonight. It was the biggest speech of his life, and he was as flat as the Florida Everglades, his words lacking heart as if his mind were elsewhere.
"America is once again at a moment of reckoning," the candidate continued. "Powerful forces are threatening to pull us apart. Bonds of trust and respect are fraying."
Jack felt his father's hand on his shoulder.
"Moments like these make me truly sorry you had no interest in politics. You could do better than this with no script."
Harry was right on one count. The political bug had never bitten Jack. Like 3.5 million other Floridians, Jack was an independent with no party affiliation, a fact that Harry had kept quiet to get his son inside the building under the honored guest invitation to the former governor and guest. Jack wasn't exactly passionate about the Democratic candidate, but he was no fan of the incumbent, Malcolm MacLeod, whom Democrats had been threatening to impeach since retaking the House of Representatives in the midterm election. The House never did vote on impeachment, instead making a calculated strategic decision to oust him through the ballot box. MacLeod's base rallied behind him, but rumors of corruption were so pervasive that most experts proclaimed him a one-term president. Heading to the summer conventions, pollsters projected a Democratic cakewalk to the White House. Pundits quite seriously proclaimed that it didn't matter who the Democrats nominated, as long as the nominee managed to avoid indictment for a capital felony between the convention and the general election in November. The worry lines on his father's face had Jack wondering if, as usual, the pundits were dead wrong.
"You know something, don't you?"
Jack said in a serious tone. "What is it, Dad?" They retreated deep into the corner, farther out of earshot from the other guests. Harry kept his voice low as an added measure of privacy.
"I had a chat with Senior before dinner tonight,"
said Harry, meaning Senator Stahl's father.
"He's trying to talk his daughter-in-law out of suing for divorce."
The news surprised Jack. He'd met the Democrats' first couple earlier in the campaign. They'd seemed happy, no sign of tension. What happened?
"The story will break tomorrow. Turns out the senator has been having an affair. I'm sorry to hear that."
Jack glanced at the Jumbotron, where 2 hours earlier, a DNC video had extolled the nominee as a family man who stood for family values.
"We have to decide whether we're going to work together so we can all rise together," said Stahl, speaking in a voice that didn't boom the way it should have.
Harry just shook his head, lacking the enthusiasm of the floor delegates, who at least pretended to be moved.
"This affair is MacLeod's answer to his prayers," said Harry. "I honestly don't think Evan's campaign is going to survive."
"I don't mean to sound cynical," said Jack, "but don't you think you're being a little old-fashioned? Plenty of politicians have survived extramarital affairs.
Not like this one."
Jack's imagination ran for a moment, but it was hard to conjure up anything in the nature of an affair that would shock the modern political world.
"Who is she?"
Harry glanced at the stage again, then looked Jack in the eye. That's the problem. Rumor has it that the other woman isn't a woman.
The senator reached for a big fiery finish, and it sounded like a reach.
My fellow Americans, there's a clear choice ahead of us. One that looks at the future with fear and hatred, or a new vision of courage and confidence that builds a better tomorrow for our beloved children, that honors our beloved country, and that makes America greater than ever.
The crowd erupted. Stahl thrust his arms in the air, but his gestures, like his words, lacked heart.
Thank you, and may God bless the United States of America.
On cue, the music blared and the bulging nets fell away from the catwalks to release the colorful finale. Balloons poured down from the ceiling, covering the candidate, the stage, and the screaming throngs of delegates on the convention floor. Jack noted that the would-be First Lady did not join her husband on stage, which left the candidate awkwardly alone, knee-deep in inflated latex, engaged in a silly game of balloon volleyball with his supporters in the first row.
You get the picture?
Asked Harry.
Coming from his father, the question had Jack thinking of two other governors, Sanford of South Carolina and McGreevy of New Jersey. One who served out his gubernatorial term and was elected to Congress after he went missing in Argentina with his mistress, the other who resigned his office and disappeared from politics after announcing that he was gay.
I get the picture all right, said Jack.
November. Chapter 2. It was the first Tuesday after the first Monday. The morning sun was a distant orange sliver rising from the Atlantic as Jack emerged from the bedroom dressed and ready for work. His wife and daughter were in the kitchen. Jack grabbed his car keys from the pewter dish on the counter, kissed his family good morning and goodbye, and headed for the door.
Why are you leaving so early, Daddy?
Ever since her kindergarten teacher had introduced the concept of time, Riley found any occurrence outside the normal rhythm of things to be worthy of comment.
I want to go vote before work, said Jack.
Daddy has to cancel out Nana's ballot.
Andy popped a couple of frozen waffles into the toaster.
Just because my mother is a Republican doesn't mean she's voting for MacLeod. I'm a Republican and I'm not voting for him.
Jack liked his mother-in-law, and the fact that her heart was big enough to have adopted Andy out of foster care only elevated her in his eyes. But he had pegged her as someone who talked progressive and voted her pocketbook.
No matter how many different ways I ask, your mother refuses to tell me who she's voting for. She's a firm believer in the Australian ballot system.
What's an Australian ballot?
Asked Riley.
It's when kangaroos elect our president, said Jack.
Daddy's so funny,
Andy said with a roll of her eyes.
It means that you don't have to tell anyone who you voted for. It started in Australia a long time ago, so it's called the Australian ballot system.
Mommy's right.
And the good thing about a secret ballot is that it stops bullies from telling you how to vote.
So stop telling my mother how to vote,
said Andy. It made him stop and think. People said MacLeod was a bully, but both sides were guilty.
Fair enough, he said, and he started toward the door, then stopped.
Oh, I almost forgot. Dad asked me to watch the election returns with him tonight.
Where? Somebody's house in the Gables, not sure. It's a watching party.
Jack, I really don't feel like going anywhere tonight. Well, actually, it's invitation only. Dad got invited, and Agnes isn't feeling up to it. He asked me to join him.
Seems like Agnes is playing the not feeling well card a lot lately. Is she okay?
I wouldn't read anything into it. I think she's just tired of the campaign.
Or maybe Agnes is voting for MacLeod, she said, teasing.
It wasn't outside the realm of possibility, and it wouldn't have been the first point of disagreement between Jack and his stepmother, not by a long shot.
Guess I'll have to vote twice. Daddy, you can't do that.
That was another daddy joke, said Andy. They're easy to spot because you have to remind yourself to laugh.
Jack opened the door.
So you don't mind if I go tonight?
Honey, if this race is as close as it's supposed to be, I'll be in bed hours before we know the winner. Go. Have fun.
Thanks. I hope we will.
Jack and his father were at Miami International Airport when the stall campaign jet touched down at 6:35 p.m. Eastern Time. The senator had started the day by casting his vote three blocks from his house in Coral Gables. Then it was off to morning rallies in Michigan and Ohio, followed by quick...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.